Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Sister Mary Norbert Bauer.
Number two.
My name is Sister Mary Norbert Bauer.
Number three.
My name is Sister Mary Norbert Bauer.
Only one of these people is the real Sister Mary Norbert Bauer, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth. Now, let's meet our panel. Co-star of Murder, She Wrote, Ron Masak. Emmy Award-winning actress and producer, Polly Bergen. Film and television producer, David Niven Jr. And to tell the truth, very own Kitty Carlisle. Here's the host of To Tell the Truth, Gordon Elliott. Oh, thank you and welcome. Panel, welcome you to Bright.
Okay, let's get right to the story presented by our first team of challengers, all three of whom claim to be Sister Mary Norbert Bauer. I, Sister Mary Norbert Bauer, am a mother superior. I perform my normal duties, but I'm full of unusual ideas. I write poetry and songs, and a number of years ago, one of my songs was even played by Guy Lombardo. But my newest idea really paid off. I sent it into Folgers Coffee Company, and as they say in the Bible, lo and behold, they actually made it into a commercial. It starts in a convent where nuns are served fresh brewed coffee, which turns out to be instant, and they're fooled completely. The nuns were played by actresses, but they were very convincing. This was my first big brush with show business. And by the way, the title of my commercial is True Confessions. Signed, Sister Mary Norbert Bauer. Welcome, sisters. Welcome. Make yourselves comfortable in our house. We'll find out more about this commercial-minded nun right after this break. You're watching To Tell the Truth, and welcome back to the show and panel. These three people all claim to be Sister Mary Norbert Bauer, who wrote a successful coffee commercial while praising the Lord. Let's start the questioning with Kitty Carlisle.
Thank you. Number one, where do you live?
In New York City.
And well, number two, where is your convent?
In Hackettstown, New Jersey.
Oh, and number three, what is your order?
The Benedictines.
Thank you. Number one, do you teach as well?
I teach in elementary school.
And number two, how did you get the idea to send this thing to Folgers?
I was
Are you
watching
a coffee drinker?
The commercial. Yes, I was watching the commercial, and they said if you made a commercial or a switch like this in your place, to send it in. And I did it for 2 months before that already, so I sent it in.
And number three, everybody loved it.
Moving on. David Niven Jr.
Number one, how long does it take to become a mother superior?
Quite a long time.
That's a waffly answer.
Well, it usually is someone who's been in the order for a period of years. And actually, you serve a term of 6 years when you are chosen as a mother superior.
I see.
And then you go out of office and have to wait a period of time before you come in again.
Thank you. Number two, as a matter of interest, what did you do with the money that you made from the commercial?
The money I made from the commercial was I was given permission to buy a tape recorder with it, but I didn't buy it yet.
I see. And number three, are you writing another commercial?
Not at present.
Oh, no, there's a mother inferior, David. I was just wondering what position that is. Polly Morgan. Polly, Polly Bergen, sorry. Polly Morgan. What am I up to?
Number three. On Fridays, do you eat meat or do you still eat fish on Fridays?
Oh, eat meat.
You eat meat on Fridays?
Not Good Friday.
Not Good Fridays.
Good Friday.
What do you eat on Good Fridays, Monday? Number one. Monday.
Good Friday is a fish day.
Oh, that is a fish
that
day.
That is.
Number two, what is the commercial consist of? How does the commercial start?
It has church bells ringing, and there are four nuns who come in to drink coffee. And one runs ahead and plays the switch on them. Instead of regular brew, she puts instant crystals.
Number three, what gave you the idea to write a commercial about coffee?
Well, Folgers asked, we love coffee, and Folgers asked people to turn in their ideas.
I see. Number one.
Perfect.
Moving along now to Ron Masak.
Number three, do you teach school?
Yes, I do.
In New York, number three?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Is it in New York, number three?
No.
Where is your comment?
In St. Cloud, Minnesota.
St. Cloud, Minnesota. Number two, what was the song that Guy Lombardo played?
In the chapel of my heart.
In the chapel of my hutch?
Heart.
One of my all-time favorites, Mother Superior.
The chapel of my hutch with a rabbit. Yes. Turned to a bunny. No. Hugh and his little furry thing with big ears in the chapel of my hutch. Time's up, table. Time to vote for either number one, number two, or number three. Our team of challengers will receive $500 for each incorrect vote with a guarantee of $1,000. And if the panel is filled completely, the team of challengers will win $3,000. And if panel, you're ready to cast your ballots, we'll begin with Kitty Carlisle.
Oh, it's too awful. I honestly don't know. They were all wonderful, just wonderful. I voted for number three.
Okay, you don't want to offend the Lord. That's what it is.
That's right. They were all great.
David Niven, Jr.
I did not vote for number three because I thought that the one eats fish on Fridays.
Yes.
I also am confused because I thought none shaved their heads, and these three ladies all seem to have a head of
not
hair.
Anymore.
What?
Not
well, no, I'm sorry. My
the Middle Ages, David.
Anyway, I voted for number one because I liked her answer.
Okay.
On how long it took.
Clearly, you're not a Catholic. Polly.
Well, I agree with Kitty. I thought they were all terrific. But number one offered an awful lot of additional information, which I always find the real person doesn't like to do, unless they're a nun, maybe, and they want to be really totally honest. And, I don't know. I never trust people from New Jersey, so I didn't vote for number two. So because I have an ex-husband who comes from New Jersey. So I voted for number three.
Okay, fine. Ron.
Gordon, I can't remember any of the reasons I had at this point because I was listening to Polly so much. I'll tell you why. I watched their hands, and when they were being introduced, number three had her hands folded very piously, and I said, that may be to throw us off. And as they came down and they sat down, whatever was in front of number three, she pushed it over in front of number two. And I think that was because she didn't have a ruler to slap wrists. So, I voted for number three.
All righty. Okay. Now, the disturbing thought is here, there are two wonderful religious-looking women who are lying their back teeth off, okay? And they're dressed up in nuns' outfits doing it. Number one is one vote, no votes for number two, three votes for number three. Now it's time to find out who the real commercial-writing, coffee-drinking nun is. Will the real Sister Mary Norbert Bauer please stand up? Oh! Thank you. Well, there you go. Well, Polly, what?
I have to ask one question. Number two, were you born in New Jersey?
No.
Oh, well, that's... Now I understand.
That's right. That's right.
I understand. She wasn't born in New Jersey.
Okay, now, sister, please, how much, if you mind me asking, did you make writing this commercial, and what did you do with the money?
Initially, I got $150 for the commercial. And then Folger sent an additional $5,000 to Villa Madonna.
Oh, that's lovely.
I thought it was.
Now, the other two, you better go to confession real soon. But number one, what's your real name and occupation?
My name is Nancy McKenna, and I'm vice principal of an elementary school.
Okay. Number three, you've got three votes. What's your real name and occupation?
My name is Ann Johnston. I've been married 50 years. I have 13 children, one of which is my daughter, Gabby, and she is producer of Classic Concentration.
Oh, congratulations. Thank you all for being with us today to tell the truth, and because you've stumped the panel, you receive $3,000. Okay, we'll be back with a World War II fighter pilot right after this. Welcome back to Tell the Truth, and let's meet our next team of challengers.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Bill Melton.
Number two.
My name is Bill Melton.
Number three.
My name is Bill Melton.
Okay, panel, it is up to you to locate the real Bill Melton, and here is his story if you'd like to read along with me. I, Bill Melton, was a fighter pilot in World War II. I was a member of the first all-black flying corps known as the Tuskeegee Airmen. Our squadrons, also known as the Red Tail Angels, were formed shortly after Pearl Harbor by special order from President Roosevelt. We were a bomber escort. We flew 1,578 missions and never lost one single bomber. We destroyed 409 enemy aircraft and earned 150 distinguished flying crosses. In the air, we were in our glory. But on the ground, we were patronized, shunned, and even hated. In 1945, a group of Tuskeegee Airmen walked into an all-white officers' club and were arrested. The resulting case eventually led to the integration of the entire Air Force. I became an historian and am here today to spread our legacy. I'm proud that filmmaker George Lucas is making a movie based on our story called The Red Tail Angels. Signed, Bill Melton. Gentlemen, if you'd like to take a seat. And we will begin the questioning of these brave gentlemen with Ron Masak.
Number one, what exactly is the job of a bomber escort?
To protect the bombers on what they call penetration into target areas.
Number two, why were you patronized, shunned, and even hated on the ground?
Because of segregation in the South at the time.
Number three, where was the officers' club that you walked into and were arrested?
That was in Indiana.
Number two, the Red Tail Angels. There was another great fighting group in the Second World War. Do you know who they were?
332nd.
Number one.
Moving along, Polly Bergen.
Number three, what did you do before you joined the Air Force?
I was a student at the time.
I see. Number two, were you a flyer before you joined the squadron?
No, I wasn't.
Number one, were you a flyer?
No.
Number three, you learned how to fly in the actual Air Force itself?
Yes, I did.
Was there another, number two, was there another part of any of the armed services that had been integrated at that time?
No.
Number one.
Moving along now, David Niven Jr.
Number one, how old were you when you became a pilot in the Air Force?
22.
And number two, what plane did you fly?
P-51s.
Did you fly only P-51s throughout all those missions, these 400 and something?
That's all I flew.
Number three, why would you walk into an all-white officers club?
I felt as though being in the American service, I should have equal opportunities.
Number one, would that have been an intelligent thing to do? I mean, one figured that maybe you might have been arrested or got into a serious fight, at least.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, it was the intelligent thing to do.
All right, number two, where there's an old black...
Moving along now, Kitty Carlisle.
Well, I honestly think it was an extremely intelligent thing to do, and I'm very glad you did. Have you written a book, number one?
I'm working on a book.
Well, number two, what is the story called? What is it based on? Is it just a story that you told, or you haven't written a book called The Red Tail Angels?
I'm working on the premise for the whole story at the time.
And number three, how did you get recruited?
I got recruited by recruits coming into the college campus.
Where were you?
I was down in Mississippi.
Number two, what college were you in?
San Francisco State College.
And number one, who is the founder of Tuskegee Institute?
Booker T. Washington.
Thank you. Number two.
Moving along, and time is up, and it's time now to vote for either number one, number two, or number three. Panel, are you ready to cast your ballots? If we are, Ron, we'll begin with you.
Marvelous answers from all of you, and whoever you are, I do salute you. I think it's wonderful. I watched number three nodding like it was him all the time. Every time someone would say something complimentary, he nodded, which threw me off.
Yeah.
Of course.
Which means don't vote for him.
Number two said that there weren't any other integrated units in the Second World War, and I believe there were in the infantry. And I just went with number one.
Okay. Polly Bergen.
Well, I usually have a lot of silly excuses, but I just found that number one had an enormous amount of dignity, and he struck me as being someone who would not only be a member of the Red Tail Angels, but would also be a historian. So I voted for number one.
Okay. David Niven Jr.
Well, so far that I'm going to be the third one that's going to vote for number one.
Well, then we're all wrong.
Well, let's see what Kitty's going to say. I'm going for number one.
Kitty, is it a clean sweep?
I think number one was absolutely wonderful, and he was quite right when he said it was a very intelligent thing to do, and I voted for him, and I hope I'm wrong.
Okay, there you go. The votes are all in. It's all on you, number one. Number two and number three, I apologize if there's a problem here. Now let's find out who the real Tuskeegee Airman is. Will the real Bill Melton please stand up? Not a doubt about it. Not a doubt about it. Can I ask you, Mr. Melton, the progress of civil rights today, what's your view of it, 1990?
In retrograde.
It's going backwards. And any advice, anything you could say on that while you've got a forum?
I think education is the key to it.
Okay. Thank you very much, and congratulations on all your achievements. Number two, your real name and occupation.
I'm a computer consultant and a jazz musician.
What do you play?
Bass.
Okay. Number three, your real name and occupation.
My name is Harry Morris, and I'm a teacher at John Burroughs Junior High School in Los Angeles.
Okay. Well, guys, you didn't make a lot of money today, but you certainly made a lot of impact, and we congratulate you and thank you for coming here. Thank you very much, Mr. Melton. We'll be back to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience right after this. Welcome back to Tell the Truth, and now it's time to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience. Burton, who do you have for us today?
Well, today, Gordon, I'd like you to meet Gary Walsh from Mercer Island, Washington.
Hello, Gary.
Hi, Gordon. How are you?
Very well.
Great.
Now, here's your chance to play one-on-one. I want you to meet a lady with two stories, Ada Gates. Welcome, Ada. Now, Gary, Ada is going to tell you two stories, only one of which is the truth. If you can spot the true story, you'll win $500. Okay. Ada, what's your first story?
I'm a blacksmith. I'm the only woman in America who can shoe thoroughbred racehorses.
That was shoe, not chew. Now, that may or may not be the truth. Let's listen to Ada's second story.
I design the interiors of airplanes. I was commissioned to do the interior of the new Air Force One.
Okay, now, panel, to help Gary win his $500, you'll ask one question about each of those stories. Let's start with story number one, that of the blacksmith, Kitty.
Thank you. Number one, when you shoe the horses, do you use nails?
Yes, I do.
David?
What is so difficult about the difference between shoeing a thoroughbred and a regular cart horse?
Well, the racehorse runs very fast, and the cart horse just, well, I guess he has to wear heavier shoes.
They have the pumps. They put on the pumps.
Is that what they do?
Yeah, probably.
Pumps?
Yeah.
They have the pumps?
They have the pumps. We bought pump horses.
Do you make the shoes yourself?
Yes.
Or do you buy them like at a horseshoe place?
You can do both. And yeah, you can make them or you can buy them.
You can get them from Hoof Locker.
So you're the only woman in America who could shoe thoroughbred horses, but are there other women blacksmiths in America?
Oh, yes, there are.
Okay, moving along now to story number two, which is about that of being the designer of Air Force One, Kitty.
What are the beds like on Air Force One?
Well, there's only one bedroom and it has two oversized twin beds in it.
David?
How much did you get paid for designing?
My budget was a little over $4 million, and I got a professional fee for that.
Ooh. Polly?
You mean the president and the first lady don't sleep together?
Apparently not on the plane.
Ron, you wasted a question on that, Polly. But anyway, Ron.
I think the world should know that.
Okay, they do now.
You know, you can't trust people who don't sleep together.
Do you trust Ron? Okay, well, sure.
I don't know what I was going to say now. Actually, no, I do know what I was going to say. What is the basic difference between the new Air Force One and the old Air Force One in the interior?
Well, this one is much more commodious, and it has a lot more technology on it.
Oh, good. A lot more commodes. Now you've heard the cross-examination. Is Ada the blacksmith, or is she the designer of Air Force One? Gary?
I think that she's the designer. She just She speaks as if she has the language down of the interior design business, and it is a bigger plane, and Commodious is a great name, and I can't imagine Commodious.
Commodious grabbed you, didn't it?
Of course you.
Okay, if you're right, you win $500. Ada, what is your true story?
To tell the truth, I am a blacksmith.
I'm sorry, Gary, you were wrong, but we do have a nice gift for you. And thanks for playing one-on-one today. And Ada, for stumping Gary, you'll receive $1,000. Thank you very much. And we'll be back right after these words. Oh, let's have a look at this tape before we go. Here's you shearing a horse. All righty. Polly, Kitty, Ron, David, we'll see you again tomorrow.
Okay.
That's it for this edition of To Tell the Truth. See you again next time also. Bye-bye now.
It's
beat
opera
and
it's
beat
bingo
every night.
The game,
it's bingo.
It's Word Game Heaven tonight at 7, only on GSN.
GSN.